You're jumping into CKCU programming through our audio archive, supported by you, the listener.
CKCU-FM 93.1. Dare to be different.
With a few community announcements, and also we'll be talking about a number of movies, Hindi movies, that are based on novels. And I'm speaking of Devdas, Three Idiots, and many more. So stay with us. Stay tuned to Asian Sounds. Our email address is asiansounds1@hotmail.com.
Follow us on Twitter at CKCUFM for up-to-date information on programming, community events, and more.
I had a chance to talk to a well-known Ottawa author and poet, editor-in-chief of Broken Keys Publishing, Michel Weatherall. His latest anthology, Love, Catastrophe, and Poetry, was released on the 18th of June. It is a beautiful collection that is in memory of a mutual friend, Yasmin Ascarelli. The dedication text reads, "To all those who, every morning, are our sunshine and bring light into the world." In the introduction of the book, Michel writes, "If I'm honest, the germ of the idea came when I first heard the song, 'If the World Was Ending,' by J.P. Sachs and Julia Michaels. So here is a short excerpt of the song.
I was distracted and in traffic. I didn't feel it when the earthquake happened, but it really got me thinking. Were you out drinking? Were you in the living room chilling, watching television? It's been a year now. Think I figured out how to let you go and let communication die out. I know, you know, we know you weren't down for forever and it's fine. I know, you know, we know we weren't meant for each other and it's fine. But if the world was ending, you'd come over, right?"
So welcome to Asian Sounds, Michel. Thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you for having me.
Well, congratulations on a great anthology. I think it's a beautiful book, a beautiful collection of poetry.
Thank you. I mean, I've always said that. The one thing I think Ottawa has a wellspring of resource in is literary talent. It's just a matter of finding ways of getting them out to the public.
Yes. I actually love the cover and the title. So tell us a little bit about the cover and the title, Michel.
The cover is an interesting one. The photographer is Anna O'Day Photography, and the actual model on it is Stuti Mukherjee. And that pose, I think I've seen that photo around 5 years ago. It's been kicking around, and I've always loved that shot. It's an incredible shot. I've been trying to find a way for years to work it into a cover somewhere. But, I mean, you don't want to shoehorn something like that into it to make it fit. So I just kind of sat there. And what struck me with this particular book was the title is Love and Catastrophe Poetry, and the theme behind this one is the catastrophes of 2020, because there was quite a lot, not just COVID. There was the Australian fires. There was quite a few of them. And it's from the perspective of love and loss during these times, as well as the undertow of hope coming out of the end of it. And what struck me with this particular cover is that apparently this pose is called Shiva, after the god of destruction and creation. And it's also interesting because I think there's also an element of rebirth and transformation with that, which is, it kind of ties into the idea of coming through a very difficult time or a year or a pandemic and coming out of the other side, I think, probably better and stronger than when we went into it.
Yeah, it's wonderful. I think the cover is beautiful. The colors are beautiful too. Love the color pink, actually. Does it denote anything, the pink color?
No, it actually doesn't. The original artwork was slightly different and it was just something missing. And that's what it ended up turning itself out to be.
Well, it's very good packaging, I must say.
Thank you.
So did you receive a lot of submissions when you initially started this anthology?
You know, it's every time I open up submissions for anthologies, it's always slower in the beginning and it's always scary in the beginning because you sit there and you doubt yourself thinking, I'm even going to get what I need to put this out. But, you know, as things, this was kind of the same this collection faced the same problem as the previous one, Thin Places, faced, because it was released during the middle of the pandemic as well. And there's always a matter of marketing it. How do you get it out? You know, during several of the lockdowns, there was no option of selling anything anywhere. So we've extended the deadline a couple of times just because there was no other options. But no, it worked out well. There was quite a few submissions, and I was very much impressed with a lot of the pieces that came in.
And you did you have to be very selective? Were you sort of picky about which ones you wanted? Or
it's interesting in a way. I'm going to jump the gun a little bit here about some of the pieces that stood out. One of the things in poetry, and this is for myself only as a poet rather than other people, is I don't practice open verse. I guess I'm somewhat of a purist when it comes to poetry. I think poems should have rhythm and meter. They should be able to be sung if you want them to be. They have to rhyme. They have to have a rhythm to it, a pattern. And that's just myself. What I find very often when people practice open verse, it's you get into this realm of there's potential laziness to it. So I tend to gravitate away from that. But in this particular piece, there were several poems that were submitted that were open verse. But what really struck me the most with them was that it wasn't the fact that they rhymed or had meter to them. It was the imagery that the words painted. And they were such a powerful imagery. So it goes to prove, I guess, my purest position of rhyme and meter is not always dead on the money, because they were fantastic. I mean, the ones as far as that goes that stood out to me the most was one called Foretaste and another one called The Sun, both by Samantha Page Maskell, because they were quite something. They really resonated with me.
Mm-hmm. Anthology, you said, is a dedication, right?
Yes.
And
yes, it is.
Can you talk about that, Michel?
I can, absolutely. It's dedicated to a mutual friend, Yasmin Asgarelli. I mean, unfortunately, she passed away in early March of 2020. She was a very good friend of mine, very supportive. And what the interesting thing, and I think that's what really struck me in this book and the working on it as editing it and as well as formatting it and putting it together, was how small of a world we can be sometimes, because you had submitted a piece called A Friend.
Yes.
And it wasn't until after I had read it several times that I sat back and thought, this really sounds like Yasmin. And when I had asked you if it was for her, and it was for her, it was just interesting that, you know, how small the world can be.
Yes.
And I think a lot of times with people, like, the world needs more people like Yasmin, and the world needs that kind of positivity, that kind of support. And she was one of the most supportive people I ever knew.
Yes, I agree with that. I had known her for a very short time, but we became very close, and she was a fantastic person to be with and to talk
sure.
to. So yes, we do miss her in the community, and she did some wonderful work, and she was a photographer, and she would take any opportunity to take photos, whether we're sitting in a casual circle or in a concert, she would be taking pictures. So that was her way of capturing her images, I guess, you know.
That's correct.
So yeah, that's... Go ahead.
One of the most endearing stories of my own experience with her was when I had originally began working on my last full novel called Gnarls of Journey. It's a fictitious piece, but the main character is an 1850 Maori chieftain. And I had gotten a hold of the New Zealand embassy to find out. I just wanted to make sure the cultural aspects of Maori was as accurate as I could be. They put me onto an individual named Dr. Wanga Watiri, in which they said he's the go-to guy for all things Maori. And I got him on board for about a year as a cultural advisor for it. And I remember when the book was finally written and the first manuscript, I was going to hand it to him to read. I was going to meet him for coffee, him and his wife. And this guy, he's not intimidating in the sense of, like, he's not an intimidating man, but I had the utmost respect for him because, I mean, he worked on the Waka and the Maori aspect in the movie The Piano. He's opened up a university for the indigenous people in New Zealand. And he's the kind of person that could have put finish to that book before it even got out of my hands. And I'll be honest with you, I was super, super intimidated to sit down and have coffee with him. And Yasmin, because she lived nearby, said she's going to show up. and she was very casual. And when she did, she actually presented herself as a photographer for Broken Keys Publishing. So it sort of kind of saved me a little bit of embarrassment of trying to explain why she was there. And I like that story only because that was the nature of what she was and who she was. That's the kind of thing she would do and bring to the table. And it's endearing.
Yes. Beautiful collection, Michel. Congratulations again. And I loved all the poems in there. I think you've done an excellent job, and it's fantastic. So where can people buy it? Buy the collection?
Well, right now, they're currently are now available as we speak in the chapters in Gloucester. And I'm personally doing the Richmond Village Market every Sunday. That's at the Twin Elms Rugby Park. What's the address? 4075 Twin Elms Road, out by Richmond. And I'm working on a couple locations, but it's slowly but surely, because we just got into stage two of our reopening. So the malls are beginning to open. I'm hoping to get it into Kohl's in Billings Bridge, and we'll go from there. Another good opportunity, too, would be to get a hold of your favorite poet in this, because most of the contributing poets all have their own copies as well for sale.
Okay. Thank you so much, Michel. And is there a contact name, email address, if somebody wants to get in touch with you?
Yes, it's brokenkeypublishing@gmail.com. It's probably the best way to do it.
Okay. Thank you again, and appreciate your time this evening. And what's next, actually, Michel? Are you working on something else?
That's a million-dollar question. there's a couple of people looking to get books published that I'm looking at now. There's also, I've been promising the sequel to Narl's Sojourney now for, like, going past 2 years, and I haven't written anything of that yet, so that has to get in the works. But I'm also playing with the idea of another collection of poetry, probably called The Burning of the Dross. And it more deals with purgation and the cleansing of oneself. So those are all concepts that are sitting on the table right now.
Well, all the best to you, and we will definitely chat again.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you so much again.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You'd come over and you'd stay the night. Would you love me for the hell of it? All our fears would be irrelevant. If the world was ending, you'd come over, right? The sky'd be falling and I'd hold you tight. And there wouldn't be a reason why we would even have to say goodbye. If the world was ending, you'd come over, right?